So we're going to look at how to reduce a system of linear equations to an upper triangular system. And this is probably a method that you've seen before for solving simultaneous equations. Here's a prototypical system of equations with three equations in three unknowns. And when you previously saw such systems, probably the unknowns or the variables were called x, y, and z, or some other letters. Now we would like to consider extending these methods to the situation where there are many variables, many unknowns. And therefore the first thing we're going to do is use chi 0, chi 1, and chi 2, in other words, components of a vector x, to denote the unknowns for which we would like to solve, or the variables for which we would like to solve. And some important fundamental facts that we're going to use this week and the next week or two are the fact that the solution of the linear system is not changed if the equations are reordered. It doesn't change if a multiple of one equation is added or subtracted from another equation in the system. And it doesn't change if both sides of an equation are scaled by the same non-zero scalar. Let's have a look at how to reduce a system of linear equations to an upper triangular system. And the reason why we reduce it to an upper triangular system is that an upper triangular system is easier to solve. Here's how we start. We would like to eliminate this term from the second equation. To do so, we're going to take a multiple of the first row and subtract it off of the second row. Now notice if you take 2 times this term and subtract it off of the term we want to eliminate, indeed that term disappears. So what we want to do is 2 times the first row and subtract that from the second row. When we do that, we get this. And then we want to take a multiple of the first row and subtract it off of the last row, the last equation, to eliminate this term. And notice that if we take 3 times the first row, 3 times the first equation, and subtract it off of the last equation, then we indeed eliminate that term. Okay, notice that you have to do 3 times this term to subtract off of that term, 3 times this term to subtract off of that term, 3 times that term to subtract off of that term, and 3 times the right-hand side subtracted off of the right-hand side of the third equation. When you do that, you get this right here. And now you recognize that we have a smaller system with 2 equations and 2 unknowns sitting right here. And if we take a multiple of the second row and subtract it off of the third row, then we can eliminate this term right here. And what we need to do is we need to multiply 1.6 times the second row and subtract it off of the third row in order to eliminate the desired term, or rather the undesired term. And what you get then is this upper triangular system. Let's look at this a little bit more closely. First of all, we're going to take a shortcut and we're going to eliminate these 2 terms simultaneously. The second thing I want to talk about is how to come up with these numbers with which you multiply in a systematic way. By the way, those are called the multipliers, so let's write that down. In order to eliminate this term, you look at this coefficient and you divide it by that coefficient in order to come up with the multiplier. So that multiplier is 2. Similarly, in order to eliminate this second term here, you take this coefficient right here, divided by the one that came from the diagonal, and you get 6 divided by 2, which is 3. When you do that, when you take 2 times this first row, subtract it off the second row, and you take 3 times the first row and subtract it off the third row, then you end up with this system right here. And just to emphasize how the multipliers were computed, 3 was computed as 6 divided by 2, and 2 was computed as 4 divided by 2. And that gives us a systematic way for computing the multipliers. Similarly, in order to compute the multiplier that eliminates this term right here, what we have to do is minus 16 divided by minus 10, which then, of course, is the 1.6 that we saw before. And when you then eliminate that term, you end up with this upper triangular system right here. So the question then becomes how to solve that upper triangular system. And there we employ something that's called back substitution. What's back substitution? Well, recognize that this last equation here makes it easy to solve for chi2 because it's one equation in one unknown. So if we repeat that equation right here, then we notice that we can divide both sides by minus 8. And if we then work it out, we find that chi2 is equal to 2. Once we know that, we can focus on the second equation. We now know what chi2 is. It's equal to 2, so we can fill that in. We end up with one equation in one unknown, and we can solve that by doing some simple algebra. So then we know what chi2 and chi1 are. We take the first equation, we fill in what chi1 and chi2 are, we end up with one equation in one unknown, we solve that for chi0, and we have our solution. And then we could write our solution as a vector by saying it's this vector 1 minus 2, 2. Now, when you solve a linear equation, you can always take the solution and plug it in to see whether you got it right. So take the first equation, plug in the solutions for chi0, chi1, and chi2, do the arithmetic, and see if it got the right answer. Same thing with the second equation, and same thing with the third equation. So what do we have now? We have a systematic way for transforming a linear system into an upper triangular system. Upper triangular systems are easier to solve. The question now becomes, how would you represent these equations if you implemented this as a program? And how would you perform the operations in an implementation? So in the next couple of videos, what we're going to do is we're going to slowly converge on something that makes it very easy to express the algorithm for performing these operations.